And, you know, you're a candidate to represent. Some of them you hear about publicly, some of you you've heard about today. For example, Neil mentioned the cricket playoff offshore, obviously, and in one of his tables, you should have the Patagonia shell. Before faction dip, I was involved in talking to a well-known Russian oil company about how they might change their approach to exploration, and one of the things we were talking about was unconventional, and that's where I learned something about what's going on in the budget. And there are other prolific shales in the former Soviet Union, for example, Timonik, which you find in Volga and so on. So there's half a dozen there. I mean, goes without saying this is not an exhaustive list, it's just a list of the ones that you could think about. As I mentioned, one of the things that you hope for, and indeed have a right to expect, is that one of the firms in the US is a much improved approach to shales that has occurred over what, the last 10 years, where you have fantastic changes in well density, reach, fracking power, and so forth. But all those things are absorbed as lessons in international environment and in Europe in particular. I'm again, and this will not be your list, but I started thinking about, well, given the modest involvement I have had, which is largely second or even third hand, nonetheless, what would I say are the main factors, criteria that you would think about if you're looking at the shale that we're on? So, think about these guys, what are the main factors you would look at? And you're trying to say, well, which is the best, which would go first in a flat playing field world, and so on. You know, we've heard today quite a lot about, let's just start with the inherent quality of the shale. This is original TOC, where is it now, what's the S1, S2, what's the carbonate content, etc., etc. I personally like the model which I think Neil actually showed as a graph, as a sketch, cartoon, which is if you look at the major plays in the US, it does seem that association with a major conventional petroleum province is important. Maybe a key factor. And obviously that logic led Kimmeridge Energy down the Kimmeridge Clay. Now, is the shale inherently frackable? And there's a lot more to that. Is it simply brittle? What sort of package of rocks does it sit within? As we've heard about from Scott, it begins to be quite a complex and sophisticated exercise in geomechanics to assess how to frack a shale, what's going to happen to the frack when we start generating and so on. The other thing that's clear, and again, one or two people have focused on it, is even in the plays that absolutely everybody has heard of in the US, the Eagle, the Bakken, the Barnett, and others, it is very clear that there are ways to lose your shirt. And if you're not on in one of the sweet spots, in one of the economic sweet spots, which you see in excellent retrospect after somebody has drilled 20,000 wells on a play, you can see perfectly where the economic plays are, which are the wells that last the most time, which are the wells that are in fact even more profound question is, can you identify these sweet spots, economic sweet spots, ahead of the drill bit in any way at all? Bearing in mind that we're talking about an international setting, as I said earlier, where the answer to that question is not the canvas field or survey has 10,000 wells and database and cuttings and fluid samples to help. It is actually, we don't have that many wells, and actually the cores from these fields were actually used by BGS as hard core for a car park in Edinburgh 25 years, which is actually a true story about the major UK field. So, you know, there has been a history in the US of preservation, conservation, storage of data, availability of data, public availability of data, in large amounts. Is there a way, if you're challenged, say, to explore the hot shale of North Africa, can you figure out how to do it without moving the shale? The other thing that's obvious is that in the US, and this is a slightly circular argument, of course, but in the US there is a vast organisation, oilfield service industry, which can drill extraordinary wells, improve them enormously every few years, and frack in 10 stages or 15, whatever you care to name, in a way you number the number of units that can do that in hundreds, if not thousands, which is not true. One of the questions I think John raised very well for us this morning is, what is the position with society? Do you have vehement groups who oppose what you do? Do you have a way of making local communities actually quite encouraged by what you do? What is actually the position you're in? As we commented, of societal support, political support, can be very different, say, in West Siberia and the older space of China than they are in Kent or Northumberland or wherever you go to name, or for that matter, in Germany or perhaps Poland. I fully recognise that lots of people may have another list than this. Up with it seems to me to address some of the issues. What I started to do, and indeed what I have done, is rank colour code. As I said, I now know that having a traffic light approach is a different thing. To colour code those criteria for each of these. And a few more. I don't want to show you a boring cross plot with sort of 9 by 7 set of traffic lights. I'm just going to look at a couple. But as I said, I started off, or I haven't been involved with until recently, until probably the 26th of September, looking at the Bajor, which, as you know, is a fantastic world-class shale that sources what some people would argue is the primary petroleum proving province of the world. And you can then get into a debate about the Middle East versus West Siberia. But you know, Badenov passes tests 1 and 2. It's a fantastic shale. And it has sourced a major, huge conventional petroleum problem. Is it inherently frackable? Well, answer is the company I was involved in is doing it. And much to my surprise, I learned that they fracked, drilled horizontally and fracked a couple of hundred wells in the Bajor. They did have a Western company, and so a few weeks ago as a partner, which maybe helped them. But they've done modest amounts compared with what's happening in the US, but couple of more difficult questions is, the technology available, or the mindset, or skills, are the skills available to identify sweet spots in the restaurant ahead of it? And I think there the answer is, well, orange. I mean, it's not clearly no, and it certainly isn't yes. The whole skill set of what you see in the US, really fantastic cinematography, geochemistry, photography, allied with real hard work on logs, cutting cores, fluid flow, fluid samples and so on. That doesn't exist, at least of the whatever the risk of some of the risks in the middle of Europe. The other thing is, yes, in principle, there is a capable forestry service industry in operating in West Siberia. But when you actually dig into the details, the horizontal component of wells is 200 feet, as compared with at least 2,000 feet in the US. And these fracks, yes, the rock is frackable, but they will be single frack jobs. So there's a sort of nascent industry in that's capable of operating in the Russian offer, but do they have the skills to get to the economic sweet spots, and do they have yet the technologies to do the jobs that are done in the US and for potentially underground. And as we said, I mean, I don't know whether green is the right colour to use when societal opposition and strong political support sort of go together to don't say anything, we're just doing it. Maybe there's a colour other than green to use, but I mean, I guess the point is there is the momentum there for companies to get on with it and have strong support to work on the question. So, you know, if you look at that as a potential oil share, you would say, pretty good. Problems that can be solved, particularly technical problems that can be solved by liaison with the West. Access to skills, access to technology, etc. But that can't happen at the moment. But in principle, you know, it's a great opportunity. So that's the budget. You probably saw within what Neil was talking about. Similar thought processes for the for the Kimmeridge Clay offshore of the UK, in the North Sea, offshore of the UK, that actually most of those things would be green. The hidden question is, which isn't answered here. Well, I suppose it is called economic because yes, you can say yes to all these things, but ultimately, still, are you going to be challenged economically? Because, you know, as Neil said, ultimately, well rates of 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 barrels a day would be fantastic. Absolutely, people would die for those onshore, but offshore, even through a existing facility that you own and don't have to develop, and you can drill cheap wells from, even then, those rates are a bit low for people. So the real, well, I'm not trying to hide the question, it's just if you go through these criteria, something like Kimmeridge offshore does pretty well. And of course, the political support to do it would be there if you could demonstrate that this was going to save the North Sea. And of course, anybody who
like me, lives in the countryside and has a not in my backyard sort of approach, would welcome the whole thing moving offshore and we can get a better in the newspaper. So Kimmeridge has potential. However, I couldn't risk, resist the risk of well, perhaps putting the Bowland chair on the same scale. And there, I don't think such a price consideration. I think, you know, there is a danger, I suppose, that the first two questions sort of double dipping in the same data, which is you believe Shale is the major Shale, it's sort of a global petroleum promise, global scale petroleum promise. As far as I can tell, the evidence that the Shale itself is the same, is of great quality, is not as strong as it is, say, for the Kimmeridge, both Kimmeridge offshore and offshore. It clearly hasn't sourced a major conventional petroleum province. And you may argue that that's not important. The thing is, it's a great share. Certainly, the lesson from the US is that actually being intimately connected with a known producing province is important, significant. I'm assured, I've not checked this for myself, that it's inherently trackable. I think as I'm sort of beginning to sound like slightly broken record on perhaps, the key question for me is whether you can, in a low data province, identify a sweet spot ahead of the drill bit. Actually, to me, being a sort of dreadfully geophysical seismic person, that translates actually into can you do it with seismic. And I'm not sure of the answer to that, though I got the impression from Scott that I can't just make some progress in the direction of, for example, being able to predict not only the lithologies from seismic, which we've been able to do for some time, but also properties such as pattern ratio and modulus predicted from seismic. But open question. I mean, it's clearly manifestly true that there isn't a capable oilfield service industry in the UK. And all the opposition you need at the moment. And the question is, can anything be done about that? I mean, again, I thought John's insights this morning were good. And clearly very strong political support, at least from the government. These may not be your conclusions at all, I mean, they aren't mine. But I think if you begin to look at the American experience and try and assess what's happening in Europe, or what could happen in Europe, then you finish up saying, well, actually, things like the budget, you know, bearing in mind our situation, things like Vajinov and the Domani, which have an industry, service industry close to them, and one that could be improved, and are the half currently producing petroleum provinces have a lot going for them. You start looking at Bowen, in fact, if you start looking at any of the other three onshore candidates, the Bowen, Kimmeridge onshore, and Macedonia, there the inherent limitation is not clear that they're generated or been intimately involved with the province, and not clear that there's a service industry which can support them, etc. So you can work through the world actually like this and say, okay, let's see how these lessons apply. Now I'm happy to take any questions or comments there. In the next talk we have is from Tony. We could either take questions or have a discussion after Tony. That'll be up to you. Anybody wants to ask questions now? Well, I've done, please feel free.
you've taken a particularly pessimistic view, David. I think you've drilled wells at 1 in 4, $200 million. And although you said, so you're quite prepared to take conventional exploration risk. Can't you look at this through the same light? Secondly, if you look at the Bowland Shale, it said it hasn't sourced a conventional source rock. It's had 300 million years in which you could have done it, could have lost it. You've got an oil service industry in the UK, so you could develop one. The sweet spots in the US have only become apparent now, with hindsight. You didn't have it when they started out. So you could turn lots of those questions as to half positive as opposed to half negative.
Yeah, that's true. So I'll accept the assertion that when I did these slides, it was pouring down outside. I had a half, a glasses half empty view of the world, suddenly interesting. I agree. But you could argue on it. Yeah? I agree with you that if you take a fundamental explorer's perspective, then you will have a much
more. Do the rocks work?
Yeah, you'd have a much more of a gather and conclusion. Yeah. Good chance. Tom, please.
Thank you, David. I remember a comment on someone who spoke last year from Talisman. And he highlighted three particular points. And there's one that I think we don't have here. We talked about moose pasture, and the one thing that led to the success in North America, in that there was unwanted acreage, population density wasn't high. And I think that's perhaps one of the things, looking at John's talk, we've got a very concentrated stakeholder, resident stakeholder around that. We don't have moose pasture to spare.
That would be another reason for something like Baginov, or, as I say, just to give you an example, when I talked to the consultants that Neil and Cambridge Energy use, they're a company called Roxanne Associates, which is based in Houston, group that does all this fundamental geochemistry, sedimentology, looking at logs, etc. I asked the boss of that company, which is your absolute favourite, based on what you know, shale potential rock in the world? And their answer was the hot shales of North Africa, where, let's say, you have a completely different set of problems, certainly in terms of residence and previous societal occupation of the land, not a problem. You have other issues. But that's a good question. Please. Doug?
Perhaps the significance of its source, the major petroleum province, is surely that it tells you that the source rock has become saturated with hydrocarbons. So you could actually replace that to say, well, if you know it's got a point problem, you know the source rock's been saturated now. And then she's pointing about the Bowland Shale, you don't know the source of the petroleum province. Therefore, you have to go back and see if that source rock has been generated, which, if you find that it is, then you can make it green. But until that's the case, it's a yellow. If you take Poland as an example, Poland didn't work because they understand because of that the source rock wasn't saturated and it had the source of the petroleum province.
Yeah. And as I say, there is a risk in the two points I had, that I'm double dipping it in finding a negative answer, whereas it may be right to tackle it the way you want, the way you suggested that. Yeah, Francis.
I just wondered whether, from your Bashanov example, we shouldn't have had something about investment dollars in there, because the nature of it, the Russian industry is such that they're plowing whatever money they have into the brownfields going.
I think the company I was consulting with has learned to do what it's told.
Yeah, please.
Thanks, Jim Hagen. One of the reasons why the US seems to work is the legal system allows the local commercial landowners to benefit from the shale. That's kind of a, it's all zoomed in political things, but in the UK and Europe, you don't have that.
Yeah. I mean, I know you only came at lunchtime. I mean, John was talking about that, and he said, you know, I think he was talking about the nuclear industry, where the companies thought of this new scheme of giving people more financial benefit from what they were proposing to do, and it had been widely unsuccessful. That doesn't mean to say it's going to be unsuccessful. Please.